having over the last few months. We're always excited to offer new topics in Tennessee history, and we have a special one for you today. You just watched a video on our new Tennessee State Museum. We're excited that's going to happen in the fall of 2018. If you go down to the corner of Rosa Parks and Jefferson Street right now, you will see the skeleton of this new building that's going to be down there for all Tennesseans. So we're very excited. My name is Jeff Sellers. I'm the Curator of Education here. And today's Lunch and Learn is going to be a very interesting one. We had a little preview of it earlier this week, and I was fascinated by it. It's something that many of us probably remember if we were in Tennessee when this happened. But it, as you can see, is the great fossil site. And for our speaker today, we have probably the most, one of the best people to speak on this topic. Our speaker was the state archaeologist for 25 years of his career here in Tennessee. So he has served us well throughout his career. And without further ado, I'm going to not steal any of your thunder, but let's all welcome Mr. Nick Fielder to the program.
Thank you, Jeff. This is the first time I've been in a program that had a commercial in front of it. So anyway, we're awfully proud of what's being done with the new museum. And I'm going to look toward the past a little bit and sort of bring it up today as we go through the program. As Jeff said, I was the state archaeologist for 25 years, starting in 1983. And somebody asked me today, what does a state archaeologist do? And I said, well, you get to go to deep places all over the state and see what other people have found. They gave me a car, a camera, and a credit card. And so I had a wonderful time going to places and deep stuff. I was talking to a fifth grade class one time, and the teacher asked kids, does anybody know what archaeologists do? And the little boy raised his hand and said, yes, ma'am, they dig holes in the ground, they find neat stuff, and they make up stories about it. And so what I'm going to tell today is a story about some neat stuff that was found on a highway project in East Tennessee in the year 2000. This is almost as far into the East Tennessee as you can get. The blue arrow on the right-hand side indicates the exact location of the gray fossil site. And normally, archaeologists don't deal with fossils. We deal with Indian remains and early historic sites and other tangible human-related activities. But it turns out the Division of Archaeology that I was the director of was created by the legislature in 1971, right at the same time they found the saber-toothed tiger building First American Bank. And that's why the creditors have the saber-toothed tiger now as their motto or their logo. But so when they wrote the law for the Division of Archaeology, they inserted paleontology as one of the responsibilities of the state archaeology office. That came into play later when the Attorney General was trying to find anybody in the state that might have authority over this site. The whole thing started with TDOT building a road or widening a road near Daniel Boone High School in the little community of Bray that's located between Kingsport and Johnson City, about 5 miles from the campus of East Tennessee State University, right off the interstate, they started cutting down a hillside for this road widening, and started running into all this black soft mud. Now, as you may know, you can't build a highway on top of mud, so they needed to have their geologists go up there and see what was going on. This is an aerial shot taken during construction, and you see here's the high school road widening, little side road coming in here, and you can see some of the dark mud here, some right in here. And so it turned out that this mud deposit occupied about 5 acres on this site, much more than they had anticipated. And they sent their geologist up to check out to see what could be done about removing the soft mud, and all these bones started turning up in the mud. Here you can see the jawbone or mandible of an animal, teeth here, and scales by the geologist. Turns out that there were hundreds of bones from an animal called a tapir. Now tapirs live in a forested environment. They travel in herds, and they now live in South America. They're extinct in North America. So the first thing the geologists realized that we were dealing with animals that had gone extinct at the end of the Ice Age. Started finding other things. Terrapin shells, completely intact. Pond turtles. There were so many pond turtles that people started going out there on the weekends and digging up buckets full and hauling them off before we got control of the situation. But to find fossils like this is really unusual. Normally, fossils are found in stone where the bone has turned to stone. But in this case, these bones had been down in this soft mud that had been wet for a long time, and they mineralized, but all you had to do was just wash the mud away from them to remove them. After you start, any kind of highway project finds something unusual, the local media just goes crazy. And this project was no different. So there were articles in the local paper in June of 2000 saying that road highway or road project stopped by bones found inside. And so TDOT set up a media day to invite all local media down and talk to the archaeologist and the geologist and everyone that had assembled to try to understand what this site was. But at the same time, we weren't sure what we had. We knew we had dark mud, a lot of bones from different animals, so we put together a team of scientists, mostly from UT Knoxville at that point. The guy in the blue shirt in the middle was Dr. Paul Parmley. He had been at the Illinois State Museum, and his specialty was identifying animal bones and telling what species they were from. So we got him and some of his students involved and just really tried to understand the complexity of this site. We didn't know how deep it was either, so we brought in a core drilling rig from TDOT and started drilling down through the mud to see if it was 6 feet deep, 10 feet deep. Turned out to be 120 feet deep. The most important visitor that we had that came to see all this stuff was in August, and it was this guy right here in the cool sunglasses. That's Governor Don Sundquist, and he just took a real interest in highway projects being stopped by things that were found. most of them had been Indian sites that he didn't care much for. But this one was a little unusual. So instead of a 6-hour drive from Nashville up there that I normally took to visit the site, I got to ride on the plane with the governor and his staff, and we were up there in like an hour, which was a wonderful trip for me. by the way, this is me here with the camera 17 years ago when I was younger. So we put on a dog and pony show, or maybe a tapir and an elephant. that Governor Sundquist had gone to a little small college outside of Rock Island, Illinois. Probably 1,000 people at the college. The only thing they were really well known for was paleontology. They had a world-class paleontology program because one of their geologists had been on staff in the early days. And so Don, even though he was a business administration major, had taken geology and had learned all about fossils. So he got up here on the side, started picking stuff up, and you know, showing it to his daughter and gone with him, and he got excited. And getting the governor is excited most of the time. It can work against you sometimes, but this time it turned out really well. So he said, he came back and told the highway department, said, we need to move the road. And the highway commissioner said, sir, we don't move roads. Well, he said, well, you are this time. and he said, this site's too important. We want to turn it into a research site. And we want to, I think it'd be really great to have East Tennessee State University be in charge of it. And, you know, I could see the highway commissioner rolling his eyes, but it's good to be the governor. and so they went back and bought additional right of way and moved the road over. And about this time, I took a little drive down the road, went into the office of the president of East Tennessee State University. I said, sir, do I have a deal for you? I said, if you can go out and hire a first-class paleontologist, you will have a world-class site and a world-class program in paleontology, and it'll put East Tennessee State on the map, and it'll be much better than what they got at UT. There's a lot of competition between East Tennessee State and UT, going back for years and years, and so that appealed to his self-interest as well. But he did, so he hired a paleontologist and started the whole program. They took the excavation areas that they had been partially disturbed by the highway construction and just left them as they were. They came in and set up tents or structures for the paleontologists to work. And then people started showcasing off the various kinds of bones, et cetera, that were being found. The tapirs were the most numerous. There were hundreds of them found. And the mineralization of the bone left beautiful specimens. Again, instead of having to chip these out of the rock, you just wash the mud off, and this is what you have. The teeth had mineralized to almost a pearl-like luster. This is an artist's rendering of a taper with their cute little young tapers, based on modern examples, but pretty much what we think they were. It turns out that this site had been a sinkhole that was like a watering hole, pond, but it had very steep sides, and the animals would come up to the sinkhole and slide into the water and drown. For thousands and thousands of years, you had accumulated bones from dead animals and plants, but it turns out that the area never dried out. It stayed wet for a long time. At this point, we were thinking that this site was probably maybe 20,000, 50,000 years old back from the end of the ice ages. That was the operating assumption that we worked on. So we started, getting the bones out, taking them back to the university, identifying all the various species that were involved. And a couple of teeth turned up that nobody knew what they were. So we asked Paul Parmalee to take them up to the Illinois State Museum and see if he could identify them based on their collection, which he did. And the guy looked at it and says, what you've got is a rhino tooth. And then we started looking at other bones that we found. These are the wrist bones from a rhinoceros. Very well preserved. And in fact, they started excavating more. They found complete rhinoceros, a rhinoceros with young, a fetal rhinoceros. And so a whole herd of rhinoceros had fallen into this pond and drowned. Here's what the rhino skull ended up looking like. Now, this is the species. Now, the one we have at gray are a little bit longer legged than this one, and not much. But it was a well-known species of ancient rhino. But what to our surprise, it turns out that this rhino went extinct 4.5 million years ago. So that makes our site now not 50,000 years old like we thought, but 5 billion years old. Turns out this is the only site of this time period in eastern North America. There's others in western North America, but none in eastern North America, especially in Tennessee. So this, on the geological epochs, that puts us up there where the Orange Era is, at the boundary between the Miocene and the Pliocene. And the Ice Age is up there at the top. And if you want to, this is a paleontologist that he says he stayed hired. He came from Nebraska to look at rhinoceros and stuff. But if you want to make a rhinoceros, if you want to make a paleontologist happy, find something that nobody else has found. So there was one of the guys walking around the site, picked up this little tooth, and said, "Man, took it to the paleontologist." Said, "What is this?" And so he started looking at it. Turns out it's the tooth from a red panda. Again, 5 million years old. And then they found the skull, and now they have, I think, 3 or 4 complete skeletons of a red panda. Now, this particular red panda is about 2 or 3 times the size of the modern red panda. But red pandas are so cute. Zoos love them. We've got a zoo here, and Rockwell has a breeding population in their zoo. But our gray fossil panda is probably about 2 to 3 times this size. Also found short-faced bear, a human figure just for scale. We did not find any human remains in the gray fossil site, but a lot of fossils that turned out to be pretty special. The governor decided that this was such an important site that he found $10 or $15 million to build a museum and a research facility on the site, again operated by East Tennessee State University, and but it's set up. There's a small museum in it that has reconstructed rhinoceros and alligator and some of the other tapirs and some of the other animals that have been found there. But it's primarily a research facility that has ongoing research. And so you have right outside the door of the museum, the excavation is ongoing every summer and then throughout the year. Graduate students come in, but the general public is allowed to participate. They have a fossil fuel camps for kids, and just a really nice operation. One of the problems you run into when you are doing a museum is that you like to have an artist come in and do paintings based on what you found. We had found some elephant tusks early on, and the shape of them, size of them, indicated that they were from a shovel tusk elephant, a real early elephant, prior to the more common form you see in fossil sites. And so we had an artist do this past summer, they went back to where that original elephant had been found, that original tusk had been found, and started doing some more excavation, and they found the broken off part of the tusk. They found the skull, they found the backbone, they found the ribs, they found the legs, and they even found the tip of the tail. So we've got a complete elephant, and it turns out that it's a mastodon rather than a shovel-shaped elephant. So we're going to have to paint over our mural and change it. But these are typical mastodon teeth from a younger teenage individual. But what's remarkable about this particular individual is its size. The white bone there at the top is the lower arm bone from a modern elephant. And this is the same bone for the mastodon that's being uncovered. It's going to turn out to be 2.5 times the size of a modern elephant. And if the whole thing turns out to be what they think it is, it'll be the largest example of a mastodon that's been found maybe in the world. And so when I made that pitch to the president of ETSU State, saying that they're going to have a world-class paleontological site, I didn't know that they would really have one. And so we're going to use examples from the gray fossil site, including the red panda, a mounted skeleton of the red panda, in our new museum that will open in fall of 2018. And the other thing that we want to do is have a bronze casting of a mastodon made to go outside to make this place look like a real museum. And so now that we found out that that we've got the world's largest mastodon, nobody's going to be satisfied with just a regular old mastodon. So we may have to commission the world's largest mastodon replica to go outside the museum. But this has been an exciting project, and it, for me, it's a culmination of going to look at neat stuff in the ground to see it actually come out and be then portrayed in a museum for the general public. I think this is one of the signature finds of my 40-year career, and I'm real pleased to be working with the museum now to help them incorporate that with the as part of the new exhibits. Thank you very much. First question is always there, do you believe in evolution? And the answer is yes.
How close is the site to being fully excavated?
The question was, how close is the site to being fully excavated? I said it's 120 feet deep, and they've only gone down 3 feet so far.
Oh, wow.
I'll be around here for you. Oh, by the way, there's the Highway Department, a geologist wrote a wonderful book called The Bone Hunters that gives a day-by-day, hour-by-hour account of the discovery that's available through UT Press and in most bookstores.
Yeah. How many different species of animal have been excavated so far?
At last count, probably about 50 or so different species, you know, from everything from chipmunk to turtles to fish, snakes, a few birds, and then hundreds of tapirs, the rhinoceros, and now the elephants or the mastodons coming down. So it's going to be an ongoing project for at least another 100 years.
How did all those animals come out of the first
there's more even deeper. I mean, this was sort of a, I mean, now this is 3 feet below the present surface, which is about 50 feet below the original surface of the hillside. So when the sinkhole collapsed, all some of the rocks around it and soil around it filled back in, and so when it was first discovered, it was underneath a hillside about 50 feet deep or so.
As they go deeper, do they expect to encounter even older species, or do they expect that level to be about the same as what they're looking at?
We think it'll be about the same age because we think the creation of the site was kind of a catastrophic event where the walls caved in and a lot of things happened at one time. It'd probably been accumulating animals for maybe, for several thousands of years, but the event that sealed them in the clay was probably a one-time or event. Yes?
You indicated that there were two different areas.
Hold on a second.
Mud occurred.
Are both areas being excavated separately, or are finds differing between the two?
The clay pit, or the dark clay, is basically in an area about between 5 and 7 acres in aerial extent, and only different areas have been exposed from road construction, so they're focusing on those areas first, and then we'll save some of the other areas for future excavation. But this is the only site like this in East Tennessee or in the East that has ever been found.
My question has to do with the preservation of the bones.
Yeah.
You said it stayed wet. Does that mean there might have been a spring there?
It was probably spring fed, and that's why it never dried out. In the back. It's highly unusual to find something like this. Normally, when an animal dies, the bone it just decays or dissolves in the acid rain or whatever. But it's very unusual to have it sealed in a context that the calcium in the bone will be replaced by other minerals, and so you end up with a true fossil. Well, thank you very much. I've enjoyed talking with you. And it's a great place to visit if you're ever up on off I-81 and I-26 going toward Johnson City. Look for the signs. They've got a rhino on their highway signs, so you can't miss it.
Thank you, Nick. All right, that concludes our lunch and learn for today. Check next month. We're going to do one on the World War I Centennial. That started April 1917, so we're going to commemorate that with a lunch and learn next month. Thank you for coming.